It was Pablo Picasso who said, "Art washes from the soul the dust of everyday life." So to what degree can art heal, bring peace, and lead to recovery, in particular for those battling mental health disabilities? WXXI's Arts in Focus program recently visited Ventures Pros, a program out of Rochester Rehabilitation designed to help individuals with mental health challenges. Among the services offered is an art course where adults are taught to share their voice through painting when words fail. Take a look.
My name is Maureen Service. I'm a licensed creative arts therapist here at Rochester Rehab's Ventures Pros program. The people who come here are struggling with mental illness. They are adults who maybe have lived most of their lives struggling with symptoms, struggling to be vibrant or active members of the community. Through the PROS program, they come to us with a dream to kind of get back into the community. Art is a big component to our particular PROS program. The art not only serves as a way for people to experience mindfulness amid all the heavy learning that they're doing, but it also gives them an opportunity to deepen some of the concepts that they're learning.
Before I came here, I would suppress my stress and eventually it would cause me to be physically sick. Between here and basically doing a lot of art, I learned skills to let the stress out, not to hold it in, and I got a lot better.
The art has given them a voice that they didn't know they had. They're able to express themselves in ways many times they never thought possible because words sometimes fail us.
I'm a big promoter of art. I think it's very beneficial for people's mental health overall, whether you have mental health illness that you're battling with or not.
You don't have to be an artist to take these workshops. Many people come in and their first comment is, "I can't draw a stick figure." That's not what it's about. It's more about the process. It's more about trusting yourself enough to let go and be free with the materials. And more often than not, people are just shocked at what it does for them. They lose the sense of time. They become very mindful. Once you're able to kind of get outside of all the things that bring you down, you're able to really find a new life and a new sort of passion and new energy to kind of keep moving forward.
Joining me now to talk about the impact of creative arts and other forms of therapy and treatment for mental health disabilities is Pauline Stalbrot, clinic manager at the Evelyn Brandon Health Center out of the Rochester Regional Health System. Kevin Coffey, assistant clinical professor of psychiatry at the University of Rochester Medical Center. And Patricia Sein, executive director of the National Alliance of Mental Health Rochester Chapter. Welcome to all of you. I appreciate you being here.
Thank you.
In preparing for this conversation today, I read about the types of negative stereotypes that people can have on individuals with mental health conditions and how they can lead to discrimination in the workplace, discrimination with employment opportunities, educational opportunities, even among social networks. And I want to start by kind of honing in and looking at, based on your perspective, why today in 2017 this stigma is still associated with mental health disabilities in our society. And I'll give that first to you, Patricia.
Thank you. By the way, just to correct, it's the National Alliance on Mental Illness, Rochester. And mental health and mental illness is two different things. We deal with very serious mental illness. And so we call it what it is. And I think a lot of the stigma is, you know, certainly mental health, there is mental health is what we strive for. But to recognize that these are biologically based illnesses, just like other physical illnesses, cancer, diabetes, heart conditions. So we kind of, and I noticed in the piece too, there's a lot of different variations on the term, mental health illness and so I just thought, you know, that's part of the stigma, trying not to say, you know, for a long time, nobody could talk about cancer. It was the C word. So now people talk about, say it. And I've been associated with NAMI for about 26 years. My daughter is in her 40s and she has schizophrenia. And I have grandchildren now who are in high school. And I do have to say that I believe the stigma is not the way that it was. It still exists, you know, certain places, but people are very open in talking about mental illness. Our programs go out into the community. We have many people that speak in the schools, the colleges, wherever, and we have requests all the time. So people that are living with a mental illness and family members speak from their perspective, and it's so well received, and especially among the younger people. They do not go any place without someone sharing, whether it's, you know, in the group setting or coming up to them after and talking about, gee, my sister or I myself have thought about suicide. So in that perspective, I don't believe the stigma is as prevalent as it used to be.
Well, let's talk about what we just saw in terms mm-hmm. of the arts piece with Arts in Focus. Mm-hmm. And I'm curious to know, how do programs like art therapy, social cues, stress management, among other types of workshops that are offered in facilities here in Rochester, how do they impact individuals that are battling mental illness?
Well, a lot of times, those kinds of programs help people to learn skills that will help them to manage symptoms that they experience. I mean, the more stress one's under, the more symptoms someone's going to have. And so if they can learn a way to lower those, that their stress, that'll help them manage their symptoms better. I mean, mindfulness is certainly one of the things that's been very effective at people staying in the moment and realizing, oh, I'm having this experience right now, I need to do something about this. And you know, certainly dialectical behavioral therapy has a lot of skills. It teaches people to manage symptoms in a moment. So it's helping them to learn to manage.
Well, I think part of what's interesting, especially about something like expressive arts therapy, is it gives, and you said it very nicely in the introduction, it gives individuals opportunity to express an experience without needing to struggle with language. I think so often we work with individuals who have suffered a lot of trauma as children, and that's a time in our life where we really don't have the language to express our experiences or to reach out or understand even what's happening. So having opportunities to, in any kind of therapy setting, where you're encouraged to find your voice, you're encouraged to have an experience to understand yourself better and to have some compassion for yourself, especially through expressive arts, where you may not have the language developed to articulate those experiences, to come to it from a different perspective that's maybe a little less threatening even. And I think having multiple avenues to reach someone to help them heal from mental illness, because I think that's absolutely true. It is an illness, and I think often, you know, it's this loss of control that people fear. You know, when we have something wrong with our heart, we're less afraid than when we have something wrong with our mind. Nobody wants to lose their mind, you know, so a lot of people come in and they express, I'm afraid, I'm crazy. But it's just really having multiple avenues to help someone in that healing process.
So we learned about the creative arts impact. I'm curious about the other types of treatment or therapy that have proven to be beneficial, and perhaps some types of therapy or treatment that people are not that familiar with right now.
Oh my gosh, there's so many.
I mean, psychology itself, since the early 90s, have been working on sort of evidence-based therapies that work with different conditions, or like cognitive behavioral is certainly used a lot with anxiety and depression. I mean, there's interpersonal psychotherapy that...
Yeah, we're doing a large project on interpersonal psychotherapy at Rochester Regional Health and training our clinicians on that. And it combines a more of a psychodynamic, psychoanalytic background while also keeping it a brief and very much focused on the here and now, and that the emphasis is really on recovery, learning enough to help you continue on in your life without having to be in therapy forever. And I think that's a big shift in the field of psychology, that it's not like a treatment for the rest of your life, but there's actually an end point mm-hmm. and a way where you can learn enough of those skills to be successful.
And manage,
yeah.
And I think a lot of mental, or a lot of trauma stuff goes back to attachment. And I think there is an important part of healing for people where they need really to attach to a therapist and feel some sense of, and there's certainly even evidence now that neurologically, you know, children who have bad experiences early on in their life, their brain development is curtailed because of.
And you also mentioned dialectical behavioral therapy. So that's a much longer treatment for somebody who we would say has a personality disorder, where they're really also, there's an organic component where we're basically struggling with handling stressful situations. So really learning skills on how to be less kind of tumultuous in your life.
And actually the dialectical behavior therapies now, they're using them, aren't they, for not just borderline,
personal,
any mental illness.
We use it for depression
now. Any life coping skill, mm-hmm. exactly.
Yes.
Actually, I use some of the skills myself. They're pretty helpful. Yeah.
We have to close for now, unfortunately, because of timing. But Pauline, Kevin, and Pat, I appreciate you being here. Thank you for lending your expertise to this important topic.
Thank you.